present, so we're going to call this meeting to order and begin. And tonight, our moment of silence and the Pledge of Allegiance will be led by Mr. McMillan.
Please face the flag. Salute. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, our announcements for this evening. A reminder that the Knox County schools will be closed this Friday, April the 14th, and central offices will be closed as well. For all students and families that are getting ready for the prom season, Black Oak Heights Baptist Church, along with Hair Designers at Dean Hill, have teamed up for what is called the Princess Project. The purpose of the project is to provide a free dress, along with hair, nails, and makeup and accessories to young ladies attending their formal, and they are hosting an open house this Saturday, April 15th, in the Fellowship Hall of Black Oak Heights Church from 10 till 12 noon. They have around 100 dresses to choose from and will even provide free alterations. So for further information, you can contact Lindsay Maples at the Hair Designers at Dean Hill, 865-789-7718, or call the Board of Education office. So thank you to them. Board members are scheduled for a lunch meeting on Monday, April 17th at the Panera Bread located at 4855 Kingston Pike for discussion and review of the National School Boards Association annual conference that we attended. Our next policy review meeting is Thursday, April the 20th at 1 p.m. in the mezzanine conference room. And our elected officials here tonight, I see Chairman Dave Wright and Commissioner Randy Smith. Are there any others? Okay, if not, welcome. Thank you all for coming. Okay, changes to the agenda. Are there any changes to the agenda? Do I have a motion? Motion by Ms. Roundtree, seconded by Susan. All in favor say aye. Aye. All opposed. Motion carries. So next, I believe, on the agenda is public forum. So Ms. Roundtree.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We have six speakers signed up this evening for a public forum. Just a reminder, when you come up to the podium, to state your name and county of residence, please. And our first speaker is Courtney Shea.
Thank you. My name is Courtney Shea. I've been a resident of Knox County for 38 years. I live at 3926 Beverly Place. I've had three children who've attended Knox County schools. One grandchild is currently attending. I still volunteer at Central High School. And like all of you, I'm concerned with the quality of education for our children. And one of my concerns has been the disparities in achievement and in discipline for children who have disabilities or are economically deprived. The 2016 DEO report on disparities in education outcome, I was impressed with the hard work of your staff and of SPEAK and of Stop School Pushout in preparing that report. I think it was fairly comprehensive. And I was impressed that the school board chose to adopt it. And I've heard about the hard work by your staff and school and others to begin implementation. I attended your workshop on February 15th and saw the video and saw the presentations. Next year, it seems to me, in reviewing that report is critical because you move from pilot projects to implementation. One of the critical pieces in implementing the recommendations in your report is your changing your school cultures. And part of that is restorative practices. This is a way of dealing with discipline issues which gets beyond just removing a child from the classroom, removing the child at school, but changing the way behaviors are dealt with and changing the child's behaviors themselves. It's a critical piece, and it can change schools' culture, cultural atmospheres. And you have committed to implementing restorative practices in all high schools in the next year. And I've heard about the training that you're contracting for and intend to implement in order to train your staff in restorative practices. But training is only part of it. You also have to have staff to implement it. And when I looked at the budget, I was very concerned because I saw that out of the 17 high schools, they are losing 6 assistant principal positions. And in my experience, assistant principals take on a lot of the heavy lifting for dealing with discipline issues. I'm further dismayed when I looked at the statistics that you provided in February. The 5 high schools that had the most discipline, that had the most suspensions, I combined the in-school and out-of-school suspensions. The 5 schools with the most suspensions, each of those schools is losing assistant principals, the same 5 schools. So the 5 schools that have had the most discipline problems to deal with are the 5 schools that are losing assistant principals. That's Austin East, Fulton, West, Powell, and South Doyle. And Fulton is going to lose 2 assistant principal positions. This is especially disheartening since Fulton has demonstrated success with its pilot program for restorative practices. And now it's going to have only a very small reduction in numbers of students, according to your number, but it's going to lose 2 assistant principals, 1 guidance counselor, and 1/2 a teaching position. So I think the high schools that have an especially high number of suspensions are going to be the ones that are going to need help in implementing restorative practices. They're going to need some type of help to do that, because it takes time and it's an intensive staff time. So my challenge to the board is to work with your staff. I've been very impressed with your staff, and get their ideas on how you're going to figure out to meet this challenge, how you're going to keep the promises which you have made to schools and the public and students, and how you're going to continue the progress which you have begun. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Lauren Hobson.
Lauren Hobson, Knox County Education Association President. This afternoon, I'm speaking on behalf of the students of Knox County Schools as well as the staff of Knox County Schools. I want to be clear that I'm speaking on behalf of staff and students, because even though numerous attempts to correct the media when they use the term union in reference to KCA have been ignored, we cannot bargain contracts or strike, so we are an education association which advocates for all parties involved in education. I want to primarily voice my displeasure with the budget being potentially pushed through so quickly when KCS has been in the process of changing leadership. I may be misinformed, but it is my understanding that Mr. Thomas, our current superintendent, has had very little input on major decisions affecting staffing and the educational needs of our children. One specific issue of concern is the reduction in force affecting our entire assistive technology department. While Knox County Schools is routinely focused on providing more and more technology for our students, sometimes to the detriment of funding for other needed resources, we seem to be placing little importance on the technology genuinely needed by our most vulnerable students. I sincerely hope that we have a good plan in place to deal with this, and in my opinion, shifting these responsibilities onto other already overburdened staff is not an acceptable plan. Another issue of concern is the discontinuance of the agricultural program at the Career Magnet Academy, resulting in the reduction in force for a second time of 40-year veteran and beloved teacher Mike Blankenship, who is a vital asset to our school system. The students in that program will likely be unable to finish. I hope we have a plan in place to help them reach their goals. In terms of staff concerns, while we are still refusing to compensate our ROTC instructors at Carnes High School for extra work already performed, we have an even larger issue regarding compensation for our certified staff. First of all, it is disturbing to me that in recent news stories, an attempt to pit certified and classified staff against one another for compensation funds has been made. When the issue of teacher raises surfaces every year, we always seem to be given a choice between raises and other important resources for our students, not funds for our teachers or funding the Leadership Academy, funds for our teachers or athletic facilities, funds for our teachers or test prep materials, funds for our teachers or additional supervisors and central office staff. Just looking at some numbers, for the budget this year, we're going to be investing $683,000 into the Leadership Academy, $3,813,000 into instructional coaches, $7,940,000 into directors and supervisors, which is almost as much as we spend on several other items put together. Evaluation and testing, $734,100. And we're actually giving the charter school another $1,046,000, raising that total amount to $2,871. So there are other funds out there that I think we need to be discussing. However, we even have a bigger issue, because for a member of the administration who is not part of the administrative conference team to discuss salary and benefits with any other group besides that elected by KCS staff is in direct violation of the Professional Educators Collaborative Conferencing Act and could be subject to legal action. There have been reports in the news that the Teacher Advisory Council had made some statements regarding reducing the raises that we have negotiated in our MOU with Knox County Schools. I have talked to at least one member of that council, which says that that's not an accurate representation of what happened in that meeting, although that is what has been reported in the media. Regardless, the Teacher Advisory Council has no authority in that issue. I understand this way of negotiating benefits and working conditions, which are our students' learning conditions, is relatively new. But it is the fiduciary duty of all members of the board, the superintendent, and the members of both conferencing teams to know and follow the law. I truly expect that this error in judgment will not be made in the future. Thank you.
Raise questions? Should we just have folks clarify at the end? Can you just let us know? Go through all. Our next speaker then is Jennifer Nagel.
Jennifer Nagel, Knox County. Good evening. Most of you know me as the mother of two children with dyslexia. As important as that job is to me, another important job of mine is as an advocate. The other night, I received a phone call from a special education teacher informing me that the people in the assistive technology department would no longer be employed after this school year. This really upset me because as an advocate for students with learning disabilities, I have worked with these employees a lot over the last few years. I know you have all received emails from parents whose children have assistive technology devices and services. I'm sure these emails may have sounded desperate or angry, but that is because they are. Not only are parents upset, but this will be very upsetting to the students within our district who use these services. I know the point is not to remove the assistive technology department. The law says you have to provide it if a student needs to be successful in the classroom. But I also know there isn't a great plan in place to make up for what these employees did. One idea that I had heard was having the speech and language therapist or the occupational therapist do the assistive technology now. On paper, this is a great idea. They already use technology with a lot of their students, so it would be an easy transition. But let me explain the reality of this plan. These speech and language therapists and occupational therapists already have large caseloads, as do most of the staff within the special education department. Only one of all the cases I have within our district, only one already has a speech language teacher, which would mean that every time there is an IEP meeting to discuss a student and their AT, it will now be added to an SLP or OT, which means more cases for them. Let me ask you this. Is this best for our students? Are they really going to continue to receive the assistive technology services that they have gotten accustomed to? We are human, and there's only so much time in the day. This will not work. Three employees did this job for the whole district, and they did it well. That isn't just my opinion either. This is what my daughter had to say about her assistive technology specialist. Ms. Cobb was really good at explaining things to me and how my iPad worked. She was very nice and always answered all of my questions. She let me email her all the time, which made me feel special, and that she really cared about me and my successes. Not only did these specialists come to IEP meetings and express their knowledge on what applications will work best to level the playing field, which, by the way, changes almost daily, for the students who need this to succeed, but they came and worked with the students, a lot of times weekly, assisting them and teaching them how to use their devices. I am here tonight because I was told that these cuts would be part of the budget you are all discussing this evening, but I cannot find exactly where it was listed, and these cuts have already happened. I am hoping that this can be remedied and the right thing be done for our students. Taking away assistive technology for students with learning disabilities, or in this case, limiting services, would be equivalent to taking a student's glasses away from them when they walked into a classroom, or making a child in a wheelchair walk up a flight of stairs. These are services and devices children need, and taking away a specialist that these students feel comfortable with, students who already feel helpless and hate school because of their disability, is not excellence for all children. Please find a way to rehire these wonderful employees. Our children need more than just the device. They need the services from the specialist that they have learned to feel comfortable with, too. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Nikki Weth. Sorry, I hope I pronounced that correctly.
Hello, my name is Nikki Weth. This is my son, Leighton. I hope it's okay if he just stands up here with me tonight. He wanted to be here. We are Knox County residents, and he's a fourth grader at AL Lotz. We're here tonight to express our deep concern, both as me as a parent and he as a child, for the, I guess, I don't know if they're proposed cuts to the AT department or what's going on, but I did learn about it last night. And I just felt like it was really important to be here today to share with you all our family's story on how the services have helped us personally, especially Miss Julie Cobb. She's helped us make a tremendous difference in his education this year. And we just discovered this resource this year. So just to give you a little background, Leighton does struggle with dysgraphia, which affects his written expression in school. And it affects his fine motor skills mostly, and it's created some challenges for him over the years in handwriting, spelling, and grammar. So as you can imagine, as much as children are having to write today, it made school a really big challenge for him, and it was reflecting in his grades. In his overall self-confidence, it was really heartbreaking for us as parents to watch him struggle because we knew that the ideas were in there. We just couldn't help get them out. So he's a great kid, very smart, bright, creative, and such a hard worker. So it was not reflective of what his capabilities were. So we as a family, we believe that challenges can bring tremendous opportunities for growth. So with the hard work of his teachers at Lotz, the psychologists, the speech therapists, and some outside testing, we identified what was going on. So imagine our excitement when we found out about the AT services at Knox County. It was like a hidden treasure for us. We just didn't know much about it. So as we've kind of been on this journey with the school system and you know, learning what helped him, Ms. Cobb has jumped right in there and just spending time with Leighton, getting to know him personally, creating those personal relationships, and really kind of identifying what his needs are, because there are no cookie cutter responses to these children and what their needs are. And as it's been mentioned already, they're changing daily with all the material, the different things that they have to learn. It's been just a life changer for us. Ms. Julie's knowledge and expertise in AT has just been unmatched by anything. As a parent, there's no way I could have been able to really learn this technology and help teach him with all the work that we have as well. So it's just been such a lifesaver for us. He's able to now sufficiently demonstrate his knowledge. there's no obstacles in the way now. And we found out too through this that he's quite savvy with technology, which has been really cool that we've learned that. So I'm hoping that we can kind of continue to grow in that area, and it'll become a real strength for him. So I'm really, really heartbroken at learning of what's going on with this cut. So, I just want to kind of plead to you guys tonight that in helping you kind of understand what Ms. Cobb has done for us and our family. It's brought back his enthusiasm to learn, which is, I know any of you are a parent, that's just irreplaceable, because when they have that enthusiasm to learn, they're gonna excel. And Layton is doing wonderful. His grades are improving. We're making great strides, and I feel like we have our son back. So I just hope that you all know how valuable these services have been. I hope if there's any way to change this decision, from the bottom of our family's heart, we just plead that you don't cut this program. And thank you for your time and all that you do for our kids.
Our next speaker is James Mayo.
Hi, I am James Mayo, resident of Knox County. This is my daughter, Zona. I don't have any prepared notes. I was notified last minute of this meeting through some other families that were unable to attend. Everybody's talking about the assisted technologies, or AT. Zona is a big user of that program. It was a struggle in the beginning, yes ma'am, to figure out how to use technology to help her participate in school. Things that we take for granted, nodding, waving, saying hello, those are things that she cannot do without this technology. Used to, I'm trying to remember which year, probably first or second year, she would not greet students or faculty in the hallway using the technology. Now she goes through the hallway and she'll use this technology to say hello or how are you. She goes in her classroom. She can tell what the weather is outside by using this. She's up to about 3 or 4 choices at the moment. We're hoping to expand on that even further. During class, they read books. She can answer questions about the book. These are things, as a parent, that I never knew that she would be able to do. So please do not take this away from them. I know I have more time, but I'm just going to be short and sweet. And thank you for your time. And so.
Our next speaker is Steve Rogers.
Steve Rogers, Knox County. I recall filling out a survey well over a year ago. In that survey, I was asked who I wanted as a professional educator to represent me in collaborative concerting. I selected KCEA. I don't recall the entire list of who the other options were. I definitely recall one of the groups that was not on that list, and that would be the Teacher Advisory Council. KCEA was overwhelmingly selected to represent the staff of Knox County Schools. So imagine my surprise when negotiations for salaries in the proposed budget are based on some supposed suggestions from an entity not even on the list. And however much surprise one assumes I had, just go ahead and double it, because not only was this not a recommendation from the TAC, but this sprung from a secondary topic between a few TAC members while discussing a separate topic. So a couple questions. How does a secondary conversation become a policy? Who changed the narrative of events from the TAC meeting? How is KCEA and any other party participating in the construction of the MOU not involved in discussion around breaking the good faith agreement that the MOU is? And what do we do to prevent such an egregious violation from happening again? And let me be clear, the staff of KCS, and I mean all staff, deserve compensation on par with the surrounding districts, more than on par, by a bunch. But the process has to be correct. The narrative events can't be shifted to paint a picture that somebody wants. It has to be clear. Proper procedure has to be followed, and trust cannot be violated. The violation of trust has been a huge thing that we've been working on so hard the past few years, and we've made a lot of progress. We can't just stomp on the feet of that. And I hate to stand here and not provide a solution, but with only 5 days to parse what of the budget I've seen, I've got nothing. When I was teaching, I had to have POs submitted more than 5 days before a purchase deadline. If a PO needs that much time, how is a system-wide budget not getting more than 5 days for public and board review? So we cannot tolerate mistakes and deviations like this in the greatest school in wherever. So what are we going to do to prevent this from happening again?
Okay, we're going to deviate here just a minute, and as the chair, I'm making the decision. Two individuals, because of extenuating circumstances, were not able to arrive in time to get their name on the public forum, so we are going to grant them, make this exception this time only, and grant them the opportunity to speak. So, and yes, Terry will need to see them afterwards to get their residence. Okay.
So when you come up, if you'll just state your name and county of residence. Harry Sherrod.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. My name is William Harry Sherrod. I live at 7310 Antoinette Way, Knoxville, Tennessee. Also, Becky Rader. She is handicapped. I would appreciate that she allows me to introduce her. And she lives at the same address. Is that sufficient?
Yes.
Thank you.
Oh, you can go ahead and speak now. Yeah, it's your time to speak now. Are you all both going to speak?
Just let Pardon? Me
Are you both wanted to speak separately?
Yes.
Okay, so you yes. have
if,
you
if
have
we get rid of the protocol, maybe, or whatever, she's relinquishing her time to me. She is a retired school teacher and retired with calls. I'm probably not going to take 10 minutes.
Mr. Duper.
If she needs to get up and speak for herself, she can, but it's just not really comfortable because of her stroke. Thank you for your consideration.
What? The policy says 5 minutes, so in order to do that, the board would have to vote. So if you can just start and speak really quickly for both of you.
I will certainly do the best I can. I wasn't taught to speak fast. Pardon me, I was trained, my curriculum vitae is being handed out. I'm just a little engineer that graduated from the University of Tennessee.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Since retirement from Knoxville Private Enterprise, I dedicated my life now to teach at Knox County Schools in the special ed department because my brother was special ed. He passed, and I'm committing my life to that. Please don't give me any halos for that. It's not easy to teach at the school system. And I'm not here to address that. I'm here to address such as board meetings on Wednesday night when I'm supposed to be at church. But let's forget about that. I'm here to address the I'm trying to find the right word because I wasn't prepared. I did not even know there was a board meeting tonight. It's not very well published, but I'm not here to address that. I'm here to address simply the morale of the teachers that I see having worked 2 years in the school system in the special ed. Now, I'm not talking about the special ed department. We feel that we need more notification, just as this gentleman, I think he said, did I understand this gentleman back here, that here we are voting on a budget and it's only been in front of the public for a bit? The teachers wanted a raise. I don't want a raise. I'm retired. I don't care. I'm not working for money. I'm a teacher assistant. I'm supporting the teachers. They just need more help. I have put my name online to go work somewhere else because in this system of the state of Tennessee, I have found hundreds of jobs with more money than Knox County. I was raised in Knox County under Mildred Doyle. I'm sure some of you, Mike, you might remember that. Oh, by the way, I know this guy. Maybe he can't vote for me because we're too close. I think we're kin to each other. Again, thank you for the job you do. But let's slow this process down. I read in the paper, I did not see a news release by the, I may be incorrect, I may not have seen a release from the school board, but I read in the paper that we can't shift more money to teachers. We'd have to take it out of the maintenance or somewhere else. Well, who made this budget? Did the honorable new superintendent have any input to it? Or was it made by the ex-superintendent? Why can't we slow this down 30 days and find a way for a raise for the teachers? And why are we, by the way, ma'am, since you're whispering, I'm just going to stop. That's all right. I don't mind. I'm used to it in this classroom. No hurt intended. Why can't we? I heard of 4 firings closing the position at Farragut today. Did we shut down all the, I'm an engineer, did we shut down all the IT departments of every school? We are an accredited school, and I'm not speaking for the principal, I may lose my job more. We are an accredited school for STEM, and we have been notified that the head of the IT is gone. Therefore, and it's not going to be replaced. Did I not hear IT mentioned tonight? Did anybody mention IT? Environmental technology or instrument? Okay. Maybe we're talking about the other program. So I would appreciate serious consideration at this last minute. And my lack of planning is not your emergency. That number one, we find a way for more teachers' pay through reconsideration of the budget. I read in a paper, that's not possible, it's locked in concrete. Number two, are we closing all ITs or just Farragut High School? Are you, by the way, can I question, raise your hand, does anybody know of what STEM Academy means in IT? Information technology? Does everybody know, please? So I'm preaching to the choir, probably. So I appreciate your time. I'd like 2 more minutes to close.
Sir,
or maybe Becky can.
Well, your time is up. Does Ms. Rader want to speak? Does Becky want to speak?
I can speak.
Okay.
And I thank you again, sincerely, for the job you do and what a great school system we have. I wouldn't be where I am today if I didn't go to Knox County Schools. And that's not saying much, but I'm teasing. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
My name is Becky Rader. I taught in the Knox County School System for 31 years before I retired in 2004. And like Harry said, with cause, the thing that bothers me, especially where he's working, because I hear this and I see it, every day is the fact that you're taking teachers, you're firing teachers that have one semester in order to get full retirement at age at 30 years. That's not right. There's nothing right about that. You took away the IT teacher who put Farragut at the national level of competition for next year. Does that sound like something that should be done? I don't think so. I left the school system because of politics, and that's exactly what's going on here now, is politics. We have people in the education system that do not need to be there, and need to, and they're the ones that need to be removed, not those teachers who are so close to retirement. Well, I'm not trying to be rough. But, you know, don't take it away from those that have been there and are ready to retire. They just need a little more time. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Madam Chair, that concludes public forum.
Okay, Ms. Coatney.
Thank you very much.
Item 6, approve the fiscal year 2018 school nutrition fund budget at the major category level for $28,570,000.
Move approval.
Second. Ms. Fugit moved for approval. Mr. McMillan seconded. Any discussion? Seeing no discussion, no microphones down, then we will vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries. Ms. Coatney?
Item 7, approve the fiscal year 2018 Knox County Board of Education general purpose budget at the major category level for $471,146,000.
Move approval.
Motion made by Ms. Fugit. I hear second by Ms. Hill. Discussion? Mr. Norman?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Before we go through all of these rapid approvals, I don't know when the superintendent would like to speak, but I think it would be appropriate for him to go ahead.
And I apologize, Superintendent Thomas. Yes, go ahead.
Oh, no, ma'am, no apology necessary at all. So thank you, Mr. Norman, members of the board. Just if I may speak for just a few minutes regarding the general purpose budget, and do appreciate the approval of the school nutrition budget. I know Ms. McCallan is here, and their folks, her and her folks do an excellent job of serving over 50,000 meals a day, and in her budget is a 3% increase for our food service employees and maintaining the 52 community eligibility schools. So some good things happening with school nutrition. One of them is not good, as Ms. McCallan's retiring, so sorry to see her go, but wish her the very best and thank her for the job that she's done over the years. Back to the general purpose budget. Let me just say it is a rush job from the standpoint you've not had it very long, but what you're approving tonight is the bottom line budget at the major category level. What that means is that there still can be amendments within this budget. And I would ask if Mr. Duper, I don't want to speak and say anything that's not correct, so that the board can be assured that what I'm saying is correct. So again, bottom level at the major category level, so adjustments can still be made. What we will do, if it's approved, is submit it to the mayor. It's due by April 15 in his office by charter. I think that's what the finance ordinance. Yes.
If I may, sorry, Mr. Thomas, I will correct you there. The charter actually indicates May 1st, but I believe this meeting was scheduled as it was because your May meeting obviously falls after the 1st.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. What we're recommending is a $471,146,000. That's an increase in revenue of about 17.7 million dollars, roughly 4% increase. We're very fortunate that the governor recommended the state revenue in the basic education program. It recommended additional funding for teacher salaries, for English language learners, special ed, and for enrollment growth and inflation. So that represents the largest single line item revenue in the budget is our state portion, which includes a BEP. So overall, about $11.2 million, which represents a 5.8% increase. We've worked very closely with the mayor. I want to thank him and Chris Caldwell and his office in terms of projections and forecasts for local revenue. Again, we're very fortunate. For 2 years in a row now, revenue has been pretty good, and I've been around a while. We've discussed that many times, so I've seen a lot of bad years, but to have two consecutive good years with revenue is a bit unusual, so I hope that trend continues. But with local revenue, we're looking at a forecasted amount of $6.8 million, or 2.8%, so again, very favorable. In terms of looking at our fixed expenditures, there are some items, and I won't go through them all, but like debt service, step increases for certified and classified. It's been mentioned the flow-through money for Emerald Academy. There were a few unbudgeted positions that are in current year budget that will be in next year's budget, FY18. So those fixed expenditures are the non-discretionary things, and they're increasing, but they're increasing at a little bit lower rate than the revenue is increasing more than the expenditure percentage increases. So again, that's very unusual. Usually expenditures run about 5%, and revenue is somewhere in the neighborhood of 3%. So it's a little bit of an opposite trend, again, which is good. So the additional revenues will allow us or enable us to fund strategic initiatives and increase employee compensation. Just to talk about a few of the initiatives, enhancing teacher and staff compensation, and as you know, we met individually with each board member, but a 3% increase for certified employees, a 3% increase for classified employees, and one category of classified employees that really needs some improvement is our teacher assistant salary. So within this budget is a $1 per hour increase for teacher assistants, which represents about a 10% increase at the beginning step and about a 6.75% increase at the top. So in all, about $9.6 million for enhancing teacher and staff compensation. And let me just say, too, in terms of a 1% increase for certified employees, the cost of that is roughly about $2.6 million. So again, we're at 3%, so if we went to 4%, now does this budget have everything in it that we want? No, it absolutely does not. But a 4% raise, we would be looking at an additional $2.6 million in the general purpose budget, just so you'll have that information. This budget also supports the work that's been done by the Disparities in Education Outcome Initiatives. Feel very good about that. The cultural competency training is going to get started this year, and Dr. Ryswick, I think, says we're going to get about 55 schools trained this year and the remainder of them next year, so we certainly are excited about that opportunity, and this is much needed. That's in this budget, too, is a creation of a welcome center for our ELL students and families, and we feel very strongly that that's going to help with disparities as well as to help with creating a positive culture in our district. So we're excited about that opportunity. Also, hiring some employees with mental health background training at the middle school and high school level, so included in working with the disparities. So all in all, about $641,000 of incremental cost just to begin our work with eliminating disparities. There are transportation enhancements, about $1.2 million. Keep in mind, this is the second year of a three-year march to add $1 million to transportation. For bus contractor, our bus contractors, so that we can recruit and retain drivers. Of course, safety is the number one issue there, and I know some of the contractors have a really difficult time finding drivers. So hopefully, those salaries will be enhanced for our bus drivers. It also includes purchasing some new routing software and GPS system. And then finally, some funding some startup costs. We've been doing rezoning meetings. We have two new middle schools coming online in the fall of 18. So they're salaries for to hire the principals for Gibbs Middle School and Hardin Valley Academy in this budget. Also funding for a clerical position to come online a little bit later, along with a guidance counselor to help with the planning. So just wanted to make a few comments about some of the major initiatives in this budget. And again, I'll say that, you know, does it do everything we want it to do? Absolutely not. But, you know, there have been many more worse years, too, where revenue just wasn't on the increase. So, Madam Chair, that concludes what I have to say. If there are questions, we've got, I know Mr. Spencer and Finance Department staff is here, and also our department heads and so forth. So we'll be glad to try to entertain any questions that you may have. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, Ms. Roundtree.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I would just like for Ms. Massey to address some of the concerns that were raised regarding assistive technology and sort of the plans moving forward with that. And if you could just, for those on the board that may not know what assistive technology does or is, explain that. Let us know how many kids are served by AT. And then I did just want to ask a clarifying question that the five SPED positions that are being added, is that due to increased in enrollment? I mean, it wasn't in, that was not an either or trade, I guess.
Madam okay. Chair, point of order, are we under a motion right now?
Yes.
Okay, we had a second to.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
And then we had Dr. Thomas out over. Okay, Ms. Massey.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Ms. Roundtree, yes, we have been looking at our assistive technology implementation over the past year. We have I had a new supervisor come into place at the beginning of the year, and one of the areas that I asked her to just take a look at overall is our assistive technology. One of the things that we did pretty immediately was looked at our process for referrals and our process for doing the evaluation reports, and we've got a new system in place for that. When we took a look at, you know, where we want to see ourselves going and reflecting on the good question that you ask about how many students are we serving, when we looked at our numbers for this past school year, we had about 113 referrals for evaluation. We did some student specific or some classroom trainings for 79 students, and then we have about 140 students that are monitored on a regular basis, and that varies from maybe weekly, monthly, just depending on the needs of the student. One of the things that those numbers communicated to me, when we think about the number of students that we have on our caseload, is our model as comprehensive as we would like it to be. So we've been in discussions about how do we enhance that and roll that out to expanding the ability to build the capacity of service providers in every school to identify those needs, to, you know, to look at the assessment. So we've been thinking about a tiered model, much like we're doing for the behavior supports, much like we're doing for our supports for instruction in the areas of reading and math and written expression. So you would have, when we think about, and we do have a pretty comprehensive plan to do it, to train our staff and to look at what were our model be, but to one of the things that I would want to assure the families of students is that we are anticipating that we will be able to provide those services to students and continue the great work that's been going on. It may be a different person that's delivering that, but one of the pluses is it's going to be somebody that's a part of the team every single day that's implementing those services versus somebody that's coming maybe once a week, maybe. So really comprehensively having somebody that's in that school on a regular basis. So we think about the tier one of the things that we're going to help folks that identify that, you know, those low tech needs that students have in utilizing assistive technology. The thing that comes to mind immediately is a computer, but it could be as something as simple as a pencil grip. And we have lots of people that have that expertise. Assistive technology really is about how do students access the general education curriculum. And for some of our students, it's their primary means for communication. So making sure that we have really comprehensive training across the board with all of our staff. Thinking about the role that these, and please understand, all three of these people are exceptional employees. We have vacancies, which we have strongly encouraged them to apply for. They are, again, outstanding employees. And if they choose to be a part of that, they'll still, in capacity, be part of that team because they do have that expertise. In our speech language and in our OT department, I'm going to use an analogy of another team that we have. We have kids that have difficulty with swallowing and processing foods, et cetera. And we have our speech language folks and our OTs and PTs that know a lot about that. But sometimes we get students who have more intense needs. So we have some specialized trained staff that may come into a school and work with that team. That same concept will still exist for assistive technology and that tiered support. So you'll have the things that we're doing for kids across the board. You'll have those referral processes where we may need some tier two interventions. And then we'll still have some staff that have some specialized training, the folks that we're sending to the assistive technology conferences, so that we will be aligning those services to address individual students' needs. We're going to expand that team because the other group that's kind of been working, we've got a group that's working on AT for students with learning disabilities and physical disabilities, but we also have an expert on in our students who our staff who serve students with visual impairments. We're going to bring that team together, and they'll really be our tier three support network. Again, it's a change, and a change is always challenging for everybody. But in the long run, we're going to expand that capacity across the board so that we have some folks in all 90 of our schools really taking a look at that. So I can ramble on, but I'll stop.
Can I ask a follow-up question?
Go ahead, and then I'll go to Ms. Owen.
Just to follow up on that, Ms. Massey, thanks for all the information. So one of the, and I know all of us got the emails, so could you clarify for the board if this shift in the way services are going to be delivered would mean, I guess, twofold, increased caseload for folks that already maybe have a heavy caseload, and then would that mean there's a need to revisit lots of IEPs? That was a question that we had received, so.
That the question to number one, shifting of caseload, there will be somebody that will have to implement services, yes. But we look at caseloads across the board and adjust those every year based on what the student needs are. So we will take into account the 140 students that are currently being served. So yes, we would look at that and make those adjustments when we assign caseloads. And your second question was about, sorry, repeat that for me.
IEPs, I know you have IEP meetings yearly.
The IEP team meeting, there is one that has AT listed as a specific service on the IEP, but we would be implementing that service. Whatever services on the IEP would be implemented on that IEP.
I guess to clarify my question, this isn't going to mean a bunch of meetings or a bunch of IEPs have to be redone, I guess would be a better way to phrase
no,
that.
No, ma'am.
Thank you.
Okay, Ms. Owen.
If Mr. Thomas could clarify for us, what exactly is considered to be a major category level? Is that just the three categories that are listed in the agenda?
Yes, ma'am. Major category levels, personal services, which are salaries, benefits, supplies, materials, contracted services, and other charges.
Okay, so if we approve the broad category of the general purpose budget, then we have approved those lines within it, and we can't change those lines later.
Well, you can. We would have to, and I believe Gary nodded for me too, but we'd come back to the board if we're changing from salary level to contracted services or something along that nature. If we make changes, or if you make changes within the category, then approve it, then those were just changes we make. But if we're going from one category to another category, and I believe I'm correct on that, that would take the board approval. So, for example, contracted services, you wanted to move money from there into personal services, then board action.
Okay.
It would amend the budget and then take board action.
Okay. And you're already aware of my concerns, but Madam Chair, if I can make you aware too. Since 2010, I've been trying to see this school district's bottom line, every dollar spent. I've asked for detailed budget year after year after year. My board reps have asked for detailed budget year after year after year. The community has asked year after year, and never have we gotten that. It's ridiculous at this point in time that we cannot look and see where every dollar is going. Our taxpayers deserve to see where every dollar is going. They deserve to see that before we vote on it, and we deserve to see it before we vote on it. We should be able to see everything. If we want to know where a dollar came from and follow the path of that dollar until it's spent, we should be able to see that, and any one of our citizens should be able to see that. I requested it 2 weeks ago also. We still can't get to that level, and I don't understand why we are refusing to give that information to our public. We have new positions in this budget that we haven't approved, positions that were created maybe last year that, gee, now we have to pay for them. And I think we spent a lot of time talking about that, that those don't just magically get funded. Whether we approve them or not, there they are, and there we have to vote now to pay for them somehow. There are concerns throughout this budget, and I think if we are going to be required to submit a budget to County Commission in May, we should have had parts of this as they were created. We should have had this budget months ago. We should have been looking at it throughout the process. We should not have gotten it the Friday before we were supposed to vote on it. And I think it's a huge disservice to our community. It's seriously lacking in fiduciary responsibility and any other lacking words I could come up with. I realize we have to submit it to County Commission, but I think we need to spend an enormous amount of time looking at this very carefully and amending it thoroughly.
Thank you, Ms. Owen. Ms. Horn.
I agree, Ms. Owen, that we definitely needed more time with this budget, and there are a lot of questions. And I think the format that it's presented, in which that it's presented, is difficult to follow, confusing, and so I have several suggestions for how we can do this better next year. And so I completely agree. I do have another question for Ms. Massey regarding the assistive technology. That was one thing I couldn't find where that would be, what project code that would fall under in the detail, if you can tell me that. Where those cuts were made in the budget.
So the cuts are actually, they're in the general purpose staffing, and Gary, I would defer to you to tell me this. I don't have those numbers memorized. I'm okay. Sorry. And it's actually a repurposing of those positions for some teaching positions that are needed.
That's what I did have a question. So in trying, I'm assuming that caseloads are pretty full for speech pathologists currently. So are positions being added that are going to fall into the tiers like you were talking about?
So we don't currently have a position slotted to increase our speech language caseload. We didn't have a request for an increase in that area. But again, when you look at how the students are scheduled across the district, we will take that into account when we make the assignments of the schools. So I think that we have, again, not that, I mean, all special education caseloads are tight. And that's why you see my request for some additional teaching positions. But at this point, we have not requested an additional speech language position. We think we can absorb those without making that request at this point in time.
Okay. And I know that this group has done extensive training. Knox County Schools has paid for them to go to different conferences, that type of thing. So who will be training the folks who are going to be doing this job now, doing this work, who will be training them?
I anticipate that those I mean, I can't guarantee, but I anticipate that those employees will still be with us. Again, I can't guarantee that. They may choose to work someplace else. But if not, we have many people on our staff with expertise. We have people that are occupational therapists. We have several people that have gone to different trainings and have some skill sets. But we would utilize some of, if we have those people employed that are in those positions currently, we would continue to utilize those skill sets along with their other expertise.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, Ms. Massey, I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
It sounds like to me that it's a whole different philosophy. It's not as much about positions or people as whoever the supervisor was brought a plan to you, and it's about a whole different philosophy. Is that accurate in how you're reshaping, reforming these services?
It is definitely about how do we expand and build that capacity and that ongoing conversation about how to do that. I want to be very clear that the people in that position are really outstanding employees, and we are very interested in maintaining those, but we also want to continue to broaden the scope and the capacity of everybody so that we can, again, when you think about those numbers of students who really maybe would benefit from some additional services, I anticipate that there could be some growth there.
And I would expand the broadening of capacity. I find it frustrating, as we've seen in the past, that people are let go and then rehired. I don't think that's just my personal opinion, but best practice to go through being riffed and the emotions of that, and then, okay, now we're going to rehire you. Especially when you say they're as valuable as they are. One comment that I would like to make is that, having been in the schools, and I know what a difficult decision it is as administrators are told they have to riff positions, that I was fortunate to work for principals and administrators that first always looked for attrition and retirement. Mm-hmm. And I know that we have, maybe you can correct me if I'm wrong, but 7, which, trust me, I mean, I know the workload that you do, and I assume everybody all the way down the chain does that exceptional workload, but 7 supervisors. So is there a place where anybody in those positions would be leaving us? Because that would probably account for at least keeping 2 positions in AT.
So when you look at the workload that those people have, do I think that we could, I mean, most of those people supervise not only schools, but also they have expertise and they supervise, well, not most, all right, programs and departments that have right, very specific backgrounds and training. So it would not be my recommendation that we would.
Well, not cutting one necessarily, but just looking at, is there anyone that would be retiring that would release the funding to where we could, mm-hmm, because I find it hard that these people are going to be asked to train, and not that I'm sure all of these people would be willing to, but to train after they've gone through all this extensive training. Now they're coming back, and whatever their position is, they're going to be assuming even more responsibility in training others throughout our system. Is that correct? If they're rehired into Knox County,
they would be part of a training team. If they would have an opportunity to be a part of that. We have a group of people that have expertise in this area, and we will continue to send, as we have, people to have additional trainings and get support that way. The State Department also has some resources available, but we also go to several national trainings. Yes, I do have a supervisor that is retiring. However, that is, again, when I look at that workload and I look at the things that we have that are in existing now, I would still support that would not be my recommendation. I feel like that, looking at a district our size, looking at districts comparable to us, that to deliver the quality of services, to have the oversight, support, and training for those specific areas, that we would need to keep those positions. And again, it would also be my recommendation that if we, when we're looking at having to make cuts in the budget, I agree with you, with attrition to the point that where that's something that we can do. I agree But we have, you know, we have, I have a responsibility to look at the delivery of services across the board. The easier thing for me to do probably would have been to make a better decision, I mean, a different decision that would have been an easier decision, but the right thing for me to do was to look at my overall budget. Where is the place that we can look at the services being provided and making sure that we are giving really high quality services, looking at the places where we need to make some improvements and how we're delivering those. And although that was a hard decision to make, I would make that same decision again. I would have liked to have been able, quite frankly, to just say, we're reassigning you, but at this point, that was not my decision.
Okay, thank you very much. And I think next was Mr. Norman.
My comments are not directed to this conversation, but I saw a couple of other people that went into. So if they want to go ahead,
Ms. Fugit, did you want to address the OT?
Well, no, mine is a clarifying question.
Okay.
Just in total about people understanding now that their position is going away. I can't remember this from year to year. Is there a certain number of days that we have to give notice to someone if their position is being eliminated?
Yes, sir.
So, Ms. Drummond,
yes,
Dr.
Drummond.
Are you doctor yet?
Yes.
Dr. Drummond,
sorry.
Will you answer that for me? I know there is, I just can't remember the specific number of days, and I think it may speak to some of this why people are being notified and all this conversation is going on.
Thank you, Ms.
We do a timeline, a staffing timeline, and the deadline for notification is April 17th, and all of the information needs to be completed by April 17th so we can notify all the employees.
Thank you. I think that helps clarify why some of this is being talked about now and the discussions begin so that people are not totally surprised. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Hill, did you want to speak to the assisted technology?
Mr. Norman, if that's, thank you. Missy, I know that you have got, I feel for you because when we ask these questions, I know if you had your way, you'd have everybody and everybody have small caseloads. I get all that. So I say all that to say don't take this personal when I'm asking this. Did I hear you say that there's only 140 students that are serviced by our AT folks?
Correct. I pulled the information. That's from this school year, yes.
Okay. That's a surprising number to me because I feel like I get a lot of calls from special ed parents wanting this service or wanting more of it. So I guess I always felt like even with the AT folks that were there that they had their hands full just trying to take care of what was there. I'm very troubled about it looks like we're robbing Peter to pay Paul because I looked at the fact that we're adding five special ed positions, and then I think I heard you say in the conversation that the money from these AT people are going towards these five positions. Is that correct?
That is not correct. I have asked for an additional five positions, and then we are repurposing for some additional positions. We've had, and I'll have to get you the numbers. I don't have them off the top of my head, but we are slated to open up some of our classrooms with our most intensively disabled students with as many as 17 or 18 students. And I know you know that that's where we need additional teaching positions.
Okay, so those are truly five.
Five teaching positions, plus we will repurpose this dollars towards additional teaching positions.
Repurpose the
dollars that were utilized for AT to additional teaching positions.
Okay. And I hear what you're saying about trying to spread it around, basically, what they did. We all know that our OT, our PT, our speech and language, their caseloads are already just ridiculous. I talked to an OT person who tells me, you know, their standard of best practices is approximately 40 cases, a caseload of 40 a week, or 40, probably a month. and that they carry roughly anywhere from 120 to 150, you know. I mean, I could say that in probably every field, that we've got in Knox County schools that is outside of the classroom, that whatever best practices, whether it's OT, PT, psychologists, social workers, that we all carry caseloads way beyond what best practices should recommend. I just do not see how it is possible to take these three positions and expect these other positions that are already way over in caseload and expect them to absorb any more work and still meet a level of service that our special ed kids need for this AT training, especially given the fact that every year something is new and different in AT training. I mean, you know, the field is just changing.
Oh, it's changing every day.
You know, every day, and you know, parents will call and say, what about this, what about that, and it's something I haven't even heard of yet, you know, and so to remove the, really, in my mind, the not enough AT people to start with, and take those positions away, and then expect others that already have more on their plate than they can handle to pick it up, I just do not think is a realistic expectation in our system. Now, where's the money going to come from? That's something that just may be put back with you all if the board sees it the way that I do. But I just cannot support this this cutting on these positions here. And I appreciate the fact that probably all three of these people will not be out of jobs. That's a huge thing to know. Mm-hmm. But this is a situation where really it's almost more about the job than it is the person. This does appear to be a critical job that is very much needed. I have a pretty good handful of parents that call me with their kids that rely on these. And I mean, they're the ones that are educating me about how more and more technology is needed. So again, I don't know what the board's pleasure might be. Another thing that I have concern relating to this, but it's even more on a general scale, is, and it has to do kind of, Ms. Owens, with what you were saying, is the way just the whole budget's presented, is that I was looking and celebrating this, not realizing that we were losing this. And we've just got to have some more clarification in that type of thing when, you know, when our budgeting occurs. It's great that we're getting new classroom teachers and new satellite teachers, and I support all of that, but not at the expense of having another service cut. So that's on our list for next year's budgeting. Thank you.
Ms. Owen, did you want to speak to AT? Mr. Norman's waiting on his item, but do you want to speak to AT?
It's a fast question.
Okay.
Does the number of 140 students include assistive technology used for full class instruction?
It is the students that these folks are specifically serving.
Okay, so if they serve a teacher in a classroom for their whole class, how would that work?
That's not the role that they serve. That's not, they're paid for specifically to address students with disabilities. There's another job role that does that piece for serving whole classrooms.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Ms. Deathbridge.
Yes, thank you. Missy.
Yes, ma'am.
As we know, there's only so much in this pie that we're trying to divide up. There's so much money you have in your budget. So, and I understand you said that what you're doing is taking the positions that you have and trying to reallocate to meet more needs. Is that what I understand you're doing?
Yes, ma'am. We are looking at a more tiered approach to how could we have a wider touch on more students for this
okay,
service.
So the individuals that came here and spoke tonight, will they be able to continue having the type of service that they spoke of and hopefully be able to continue the progress they've made?
Absolutely. Maybe not with the same person, but right. Absolutely continue those services.
Okay. And so those that have been riffed, I've worked at TVA, I understand riffs, and it's always good to know if you're losing a job that there's one that's available if you qualified. So it's not like you're throwing them out and then bringing them back, but you're giving them opportunities. So we're talking right now, how many RIF positions? Five? Is it three?
For special education specifically?
For this AT. Oh,
there are three of them.
Three of them.
Yes, ma'am.
And if they stay inside Knox County Schools, you also use them to help train others to be able to do this so that we can do it a little bit more widespread.
We would like to utilize them, yes. Them and other people who have that areas of expertise.
And I understand that the caseload may be heavy, but I think that is where we're going, because every time we reduce staff or we reduce central office included in this, caseload does not go away. The position may go away, but the caseload does not, and it just gets larger and larger for individual people.
Right. And right now, looking at what our impact, when we looked at what positions do we need to increase, certainly our biggest priority is teachers. Mm-hmm. And I will say, if you were to say to me today that we're going to return those three positions, and in addition to my teacher positions, I would still would recommend back to the team that we would increase those speech-language therapists, and that we would still use a tiered approach where we can have a wider touch throughout all of our schools for those assistive technology services.
So with the money that you've been appropriated, this is what you're recommending we do with the amount of money you have been funded with, and to make sure that all our students still receive the type of needs. Well, we meet the needs of all the students at the best we can with what we have to work with.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Missy, I have one more question. And like Ms. Hill said, I hope you know, because I know how hard you work, and this is not towards you at all. I think some of the things can be addressed with which Ms. Owen said and what Ms. Horn said. It is frustrating as a board member to have the short time to review a document and then to begin to get emails that a whole department, even if it's only three, has been cut, and you're unaware as a board member. So I think that's where some of the, you know, but my last comment, and maybe you can help me here, because I want to know what it's going to look like. So I've heard the more tiered approach, mm-hmm. and I've heard that gives us a wider touch, mm-hmm. and we're going to reach more students, and we're going to expand with these teams. But I want to know what that looks like to those students that we heard from tonight as far as relationships, because these are some of our most vulnerable kids, not all of them, but some of them that depend upon assisted technology. And they are sometimes, for a child, that relationship with the teacher can be more important in some ways than the device itself, not mm-hmm. to minimize the device, but they have to go hand in hand. So when you say that all these people are going to be trained and we're going to have people in every school, but how will that look to a student? Will they, you know, that person have to go to multiple classes? I mean, how does that look? I just don't have I'm sure you've got it in your plan, but I don't understand how it's going to look to an individual student in a classroom who has built, like Ms. Nagel's daughter, built a relationship with a person that they trust to, and they see that same face come back week after week, but now we're going to where anybody in the building or lots of people in the building should be able to help them. Is that correct?
Correct. I mean, and we're talking about the people who are assigned to be in that school every week. I mean, right. We have our assistive technology see people at different rates, but we would be looking at people who are in that building
all the
maybe
time.
Not well speech well, language and OT are not there every single day, but our case managers are, because it's going to be a comprehensive approach. We're looking at functional communication across the board, increasing the skill sets of all of our teachers, the coming into a classroom and training somebody for just a few minutes is a really great thing, or 30 minutes or whatever time frame, but that implementation of that device all day long every single day is where the rubber meets the road, where it becomes truly that student's either their accessibility device or their communication device, and that will help, we feel like, overall improve that opportunity for that to happen.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I think Mr. Norman is next, and then Ms. Roundtree on different items, so.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just wanted to make some general comments. First, I'm going to support this general purpose budget, and I'm doing so primarily with the knowledge that, and the confidence that we have Mr. Thomas as our superintendent, we've got Gary Spencer and Joe Snyder. I'm very confident in their abilities and in their ability also to assist us all in terms of the changes that we might want to make. Now, you can't get anything probably more sensitive than the things that we've just talked about. But each of us have some categories or some big things that probably have been in the budget for quite a while, and we have questions about. I share the frustration. I'm probably as inept in terms of budgets as anybody, and so to try to get through this, of course, it's just almost an impossibility for me. But I look forward to this process. I think that we can get to some of these big things, make alterations, and with this leadership that we've got. Now, there's been people on this board for years who have advocated for different process, totally different process. And so when we talk about transparency and abilities to trace dollars and be totally, totally sure of what's going where, then the folks that have discussed zero-based budgeting, site-based management. And I'd love to see this board to start to move that way. And I don't know how to get that process going, but these guys do. And so I feel confident that, given that's been a discussion for a long time, the shape of this board and the leadership of this board now, the leadership of this system, I think we might be able to get there. So I hope we can support this budget, and then we can move and do so with some confidence that we can make the changes. We can make some significant changes that need to be made. Thank you.
Ms. Roundtree.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just want to bring, I guess, to the full board's attention, kind of echoing Tony's comments a little bit. Some of the things when I had my budget meeting and I shared with Bob and with Buzz and his role about that, I think we need to take a hard look at is how we are allocating our funds for our magnet programs. And so I just wanted the board to be aware that that's something I intend to support the budget, but I have asked for the superintendent to look at perhaps another model instead of just a flat $50,000 per magnet program. And there's been maybe very little guidance about how that's used, how that those funds are put in place in a way that's going to benefit students, which I think we've had some discussion about this already on the board. But I think when we're looking at, we do have 9 magnets, and so that is almost $500,000. I would like to see how maybe some other districts are allocating those funds to make sure that we are being good stewards of that and making sure that those programs are succeeding and doing well, and we have kids that want to attend those. And I know we have some that are very popular and some are smaller, so just having an overall look at that, which I already shared with Bob. And then the other thing I did have a concern about, and I shared in my budget meeting, was we are funding a single line item position for a school that is half of it is being paid for by a foundation. And so I very much appreciate our schools that have the ability to raise these funds and do this sort of thing. The only question for me then comes in, and I think for this whole board, should be, I think now we need to be aware that we might be getting that ask from other foundations. They might come to us and say, well, why is this school's foundation able to pay half of a position and we were able to pay for a full position? So I just want everyone to, I think that's something we need to be prepared for. And those are really my only comments, and I just wanted to ask for clarification. Maybe Gary could answer this. And yes, the organization of the budget, I wish there was a little bit better way to do that. And Ms. Fugit, I'm sure, deals with the budget. Maybe she has some tips for us. But on page C7, in the line about the magnet admin allocation, it's $426,000. And that's programming allocations in a three-year cycle. So that doesn't come up to the total for the flat 50 per school that we've been giving. So I'm just a little bit confused about the difference between those amounts. Maybe Gary could help me out with that. Thank you, Gary. And thanks to all the budget team for your hard work on this. You've all been great to try and answer my question.
I think the way you have to look at that page is that if you look at the total, it's about $455,000. The $450,000, that's the allocation, a portion of that has already been moved to other line items that you see above that. That's a coordinator position that gets shared from school to school each year. So that's where you see that. Plus, we put in an additional $5,000 for the, I think it's the magnet showcase or something of that nature, which gets you to the total of the $455,000. No.
That wasn't my question. I'm actually looking at this, sorry. The specific...
Yeah, that's correct. We take part of that number. Daphne's not here, but we take part of...
Oh, she is there.
Yeah, okay. We take part of that number to support that position that you see. And each school picks that up. It takes that out of their allocation of the $50,000.
We had already been looking at alternative models of how we were going to allocate funding. And so this year, the schools do not get a straight $50,000 allocation. Instead, we followed the model that our finance department set, and we went with zero-based budgeting. And that means that some schools are going to need a bigger lift in year one because they need a bigger lift for their program, while other schools don't quite need that yet. And so we're looking at that as a pot of money and not an allocation. And we're looking specifically at what schools need to do two things: increase the rigor of their program and increase their out-of-zone enrollment.
Okay, and I understand that. I guess I just hope it will be a further conversation with this board than about, mm-hmm. back to Bob's comments about the program evals, mm-hmm. and how is that really benefiting the kids on a daily basis. And
so Mr. Thomas has already handed us his 30-60-90 plan, and I saw immediately that in addition to the 60-day plan, he wants to take a very close look at magnet, specifically what's our district philosophy. I think the other thing that you asked for was, how do we define if a magnet program is successful? Is it the quality of the programming, or is it the number of out-of-zone enrollment? And if it's the out-of-zone enrollment, how are we as a district going to agree to staff those positions? We had an entire kindergarten class recruited at Green Magnet before. We've never had that, but we don't have a teacher to put there. So is it successful, right? And so that's already started, and looking at different programming is something that on his 30, 60, 90, we've been tasked to do, and I'm excited about doing that.
Thank you.
Ms. Mm-hmm. Fugit.
Thank you. Ms. Bounds. I too intend to support the budget as presented, and I agree with what everybody on this board has said. I think is we have to be willing to commit a very long day workshop to actually understand how the system runs. We all come at it with a different viewpoint. I came as a parent and a businesswoman. Some of you have come from inside the system and have expertise and view things from that way. I think it would be helpful for us as we begin to look at a budget is a board's priorities. And it's time to take a good hard look at how we want to do budgeting. Some people are big proponents of site-based budgeting. Some people are not. Some people think that the staffing model needs to be changed, and that harder to staff schools or struggling schools don't need to have to go by the same staffing model. They may need more teachers. I think those are philosophical discussions that we as a board cannot have in a two-hour workshop, and we can't have in April. That's not a criticism of anything. That is just an acknowledgement that this is, yes, Ms. Roundtree, I do a lot of budgets, but I don't do a $471 million budget with taxpayer money. And that requires a whole nother level of understanding and digging in the detail, but we have to be committed to put in that time and rely a lot on the expertise like Ms. Massey, who says, I'm charged with delivering services. This is how much money I've got, and this is how I think, as a professional who wants the same things for students that we do, this is how I think I should do it. So we have a philosophical role to play, and then at some point we have to allow the professional staff that we have on board to actually determine how they manage their departments. And so I just say, yes, I'm going to support this. I look forward to a much greater in-depth discussion perhaps over the summer when we don't have as much on an agenda to really talk about. And for people who really get this budget and don't want to talk about it, maybe you don't have to come, but I think a lot of us could use a little more in-depth work. Thank you.
Ms. Deathridge.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm going to bring a damper around to all this great I'm going to support, because I have a hard time supporting it. And the reason is I really hate losing teachers on the back of giving teachers increases. And that's just reality. I'm just going to be honest with you. I do. We had a goal, and I know our goal was to give 4%, and we have tried very hard. In the past 4 years, we've given 2.5%, 2%, 3%, and now we're proposing 3%, but they want 4%. And I understand it, but we have an MOU that has tied our hands on asking money. We still got some money, but we got an MOU that says we have to build two schools. When we build them, the mayor gave us the money for it, and I'm happy. But we did not really think about having to put money into it, because we have to staff it, we have to furnish it, and that's just an ongoing recurring cost that we're going to incur. But we really didn't think about that when we did the MOU. We also, when you give people salaries, nobody thinks about, there's a benefit. You have to pay for the benefit. So it's just not straight up 3% salary. You have to add the benefits into that as well. So that's additional money that we always forget to talk about. We have ongoing commitments to city employees that retired, and we still paying pension. We're going to have to continue to do that until there's not any more city employees. I'm not trying to get anybody to just roll over, but we still have that commitment. And there's just ongoing things that we're just going to have to do. So we're going to have to figure out how to get it all done, and everybody be willing to work together to get that done. I guess my concern, too, is that when you talk about schools having to give their employees that they want to reduce, or tell them that they would not have a job, they know before we do, and they get concerns, and we don't know what they're talking about. I have been talking to this board for the past 3 or 4 years about continuing to cut my Austin East. So I did my own analysis today. In the past, since FY15 to FY18, we have lost 12 positions. The only high school that has lost that many. The next school that's lost less than that is, I'm not going to mention name, but they have lost 5. We've lost 12. Yeah, you're right. That's a lot when you have a school that just got off that's just gotten off the state list, working very hard. You give them all this help. Now you're taking it away. Since I've been on the board, we've lost media. In CTE alone, we've lost media, CAD, criminal justice, Greek medicine, and now carpentry. We got audio production, but it's not going to be long before some other schools decide they're going to want that, because everyone we lose, somebody picks it up. So how are we going to sit here and recruit and encourage people to come in, or students to come into a school that continues to be cut every year. And we are losing, not only in our magnet course, we're losing just like everybody else. We're losing administrators. We lost guidance counselors. I mean, it's just an ever-ending thing. So I see where we talk out both sides of our mouth. My community is kind of concerned about, are you really committed to making sure they are successful? The kids in my community have the same access. It's all equitable. It's hard for me to tell them, yes, when we have 12 positions in 4 years, come on. So it's, yes, it's going to be hard for me to even accept and really approve this budget, because it's hard for me to see how we are getting slapped every year. Every year. So I think a lot of things that we're trying to do is good. I approve a lot of things that's in this budget, but our hands are tied. $17 million is good, but you know, really, when you look at the salaries and benefits, over half of that, maybe $10 million, is going to salaries. And not, like I said, I'm not complaining about that. I think they deserve it, but we have to look at the pie. It doesn't leave much for anything else. And since, be honest with you, I wasn't for all these MOUs and stuff in the first place, but my school are the ones having to suffer for it. And this, I mean, this is ridiculous, y'all. And I really don't think that it's fair. I understand everybody wants an increase, and I want you to have one, but not on the backs of the students, because when you cut that many teachers, the students are the ones that suffer. And this is supposed to be about students. It's supposed to be about what we can do to help enhance their ability to learn and prepare them for after, you know, good providing citizens. And I don't think the kids in my community are getting fair shake. So I really do have a problem with this budget. I really do have a problem with how it's allocated, and I really don't know. And I agree with you, Amber, about the foundation paying for half. And so, to be honest with you, I had to fight to get my half so that my facilitator, magnet facilitator, could stay in my magnet school to do what this person is wanting them to do in a school that's not a magnet school. And we took half the money of our money to give to them. Yes, there's a lot of stuff that's going on. And I agree with the lady says politics. It is. And we have to figure out, are we going to really educate the kids right, or are we going to play politics? But right now, I have a hard time feeling good about this budget.
Thank you, Ms. Etheridge. Ms. Owen?
Before we look at cutting any kind of positions that directly impact instruction, I think we need to look at a lot of those positions that have been added over the years that do not directly impact instruction. We are spending $1 million on our PR department alone. We have a memo here that says that we are increasing our overall budget 4%, our whole budget a 4% increase, yet we're removing positions. That's kind of ridiculous. We also have an MOU with our professional educators, an MOU that was... it took a very long time to create, and very often was felt that it wasn't being negotiated in good faith. And so for us to have a 4% increase in our budget and not honor our promise to give a 4% raise that we have in that memorandum of understanding, I think is very, it really questions whether we did that in good faith, whether we accepted that MOU in good faith, and whether we're following it in good faith. I believe it's still the same MOU that I worked on. I don't think we've done a new one yet. And so we haven't seen what we might look at in the future, but this board approved 4% every year that the funds were available. We never approved saying 4%, or maybe we'll give it to some other group. And in the law, it says that that is the group that is slated to conference. And so if we ignore the law that says that we are required to have collaborative conferencing, and we ignore the law that says that we are to create an MOU, then I think we are really setting ourselves up for some problems in the future.
Okay, Ms. Roundtree.
Thank you, Madam Chair. and I guess this would, Terry's probably, I know she's keeping notes over there, this would be a good thing that we probably need to discuss, and we have further in-depth discussion of the budget is, and I think it might speak to some of Ms. Dethridge's point, the funding mechanism or how Title I is allocated now. I don't think.
Janae Hart.
Yeah, I don't think Janae is here. Anyway, and I could be sharing this incorrectly, but the funding has changed for that, and now it's direct services. And I know I talked to one of my principals, and you know, just sharing about the community and that, you know, the folks may not actually get and use the services, but that doesn't mean the need isn't there. And so, for the Title I funding, it's looking like, oh, that the community maybe is not as impoverished as it is when it's not showing a clear picture. So I think that's just something that we need to be, you know, have in the back of our minds, I guess, because I know due to that funding change, one of my smallest schools, their need hasn't changed. They didn't, you know, nobody, tons of people suddenly didn't win the lottery in South Knoxville. If you did, you know where to find me. but they're losing two teaching positions in a small school. That has a huge impact, especially when their financial, you know, the needs of the kids haven't changed. So I think that's something maybe we just should discuss as a board, and we need to talk about, you know, to the folks at the state level about the realities of that, because you know, there are lots of different situations when people are not directly being served, but we still have our kids that are living in poverty and don't maybe have the access. Yes, they don't self-identify. Thank you, Patty. Thank you.
Okay, let's see who was next. Ms. Hill.
Thank you, Ms. Roundtree, because that was something also on my radar, too. Title I does have a huge impact on our system, and I know that Title I's been, that they've had their cuts also this year too. I'm not real pleased with the way we're handling even this right now, because I think that we should have Title I in front of us also. We need to see how that is impacting our schools also. Even though it's two different budgets, in the end, it's still going to our schools servicing our kids. I want to see what that looks like. I don't think that's an unreasonable request before we pass a budget, given that it's millions and millions of dollars. So I just put that on the table. Another thing I wanted to ask about, I got a call as I was actually driving to this meeting about, and I don't know what this position is called, but apparently we have a lead evaluation position, someone that works with lead teachers that mentors or supervises them. Can someone clarify that for me? What that position is, because I understand they were cut also. Is that correct?
Oh, I'm sorry. Somebody? Yes. I was trying to follow here. Mr. Rice.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Yes, so I can actually probably, I know you, there's a few questions about Title I. I talked to Ms. Harley. She wasn't able to be here today, but or tonight, but she does on the May agenda, the Title I budget and all the consolidated budget with IDEA and Title II. A and Title III will all be part of that, and so I know so there'll be some communication out about that. You are, if I could address that too, because you asked that about Title I. That is true. The state made that change from the federal about the direct cert verse up until last year, and we got a one-year extension last year to be able to continue to do our household surveys and then calculate those in, so our percentages were higher in Title I schools, so they were able to receive more dollars. This year, that you know, our one-year extension of that was taken away. The rest of the state had to do that last year. So that's why we're seeing the change. On top of that, they're projecting about a 13% federal cut from Title I funds. So that's kind of a perfect storm of what's happened with some of that. But you'll be seeing that budget soon, and Ms. Harley will be able to speak to that when that comes out. You mentioned the district lead teachers, I think is what you're referring to. So we've had four positions since the team evaluation kind of came on board, and they have kind of served in different capacities over the last couple of years, but mainly in that support for evaluation. So if we had a new principal maybe who was, or a new team of principals who were working on how to calibrate with evaluation scores around the team rubric and just really kind of overall education of the team rubric, they were initially brought on board to help with some of those things. We've seen them fill various roles. One in particular this year actually went and served as an AA because they're all very highly qualified teachers and potential coach or administrator kinds of folks. It is tough when you make decisions in a budget like this. All of those folks we think are going to land in great jobs with us and are on the list to do that. But you know, some of that came to choices of where and our function were. Some of that was, you know, we have kind of in our same decision making with that with RTI coaches and with some of those things that we had to look at. So good news is two things. One, I think all those folks are going to land in positions with us and are highly qualified people for those positions. And then I would say this too, there will be, and the idea was always that we would move that level of support back to the principals and the teams of administrators and the lead teachers being the primary evaluators and always have been. So this has kind of been an extra layer of support for that. So shouldn't be felt that much. They were kind of used upon request for training and for rubrics and things like that. So, you know, again, when we looked at our overall value of all those positions with what we need to do moving forward, we felt that that was probably one in this budget that was, we could, you know, again, RTI coaches and things like that to us were direct cert to kids were critical. And they have critical roles too, and I said they'll end up with us, but that's just kind of explanation of the decision around that process.
And I appreciate too that hopefully that these four people will land in another job. Although, if we go on with the new evaluation system next year, we are still probably going to have a need for that support. But this all goes back to, this is another four positions that I don't think any of us knew about. And so that's seven positions that we know about that are being done away or repurposed. So where's that money going? I mean, I know I sound very simple in all this, but I just am. While I've got the mic, I also want to clarify on the 3% raise. I understand that we are doing a $1 across the board for TAs per hour. Is that correct, Mr. Spencer? And this is only educational assistants, people that fall under that. So like our, like we have a category satellite intervention, educational assistants, are they also included in that? Okay.
Than just the EA pay scale.
All right, so it's just the EA.
That's correct.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And then once they get the dollar an hour, which I totally support, then they also get 3% like everyone else on top of that?
No, they just get their step increase at that point.
Okay. And the 3% is on a person's base salary, is that correct?
Where they fall on a step, or on the scale, it'd be 3%.
Where they fall on the step, not a zero. So, you know, sometimes raises come through and it's at step zero.
Right.
And that's the amount that gets the raise.
Well, each one of the salaries on the step will be increased by 3%.
Okay.
So a person who's moving to the next step will get the step increased by 3% as well. I mean, it's like if you're on the step now and you're making $100 and you're stepping up to $200, well, you're stepping away from $200 up to $206 because that's the next step will increase by 3%.
All right, I got you. Okay, thank you. I have a real problem with waiting until May on this Title I stuff, because I do think it is so integral with what we're talking about now and where to plug in these, you know, positions that have been cut. Or like I said, we're talking about, and I know that there's not enough money to go around. I know there's not, but just even identifying these positions and hearing that others, as in the AT deal, are other people are going to have to assume more and more. But yet, overall, we have a total increase in the percentage of money that we're receiving. And I fully accept this probably won't go anywhere, but I personally would really like to wait until Monday. We have a workshop scheduled. Perhaps we could have a special called meeting then.
No, that was canceled.
Oh, the Monday
place
one did?
Yes. Well, this took the place
shows
of
shows what I know. So we're not meeting again until May?
Till May. Our workshop will be the first one.
Mm-mm. Well, I just, I'm just not, it isn't that I'm not comfortable with the amount of money we're going to county commission with. I understand that is what it is. What I'm not comfortable with is really having all the pieces of what's been presented to us right now.
Thank you, Miss Hill. We've got four other people that want have their mics down and want to speak, but since Miss Hartley's not here, Dr. Rice, do we have a total amount that you can divulge that we've lost in Title I, II, and III money? Do you know how much that the perfect storm has cost Knox County Gary Schools?
Yeah,
oh, would, Gary
yeah.
knows?
Mr. Spencer.
We should have seated you up here tonight. Go ahead.
The latest, and these are just the latest estimates. These won't be missed either. They're not finalized until July, right? Is that?
We do not have. Title I has their
preliminary
allocation.
Okay. Well, and for the total Title I budget and the actual for 2017 was $16.2 million. They're estimating a projection for this coming year of right at $14 million. So that's a loss of $2.2 million. And that's in the Title I. Title II is around $2 million, and it's going to go down to $1.8 million. So they're losing $200,000. And of course, the caveat here is these are still preliminary numbers. And that's one of the reasons it takes until May, because these are constantly being worked by the state.
Okay, thank you. And I guess now we'll go to Ms. Dethridge, and then we'll go to Ms. Horn and Mr. McMillan, and then back to Ms. Fugit.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair. I was just going to say, with the Title I money, I did meet with Janae, because it's going to affect, my preschools are strictly Title I. So when you had a $2.2 million cut, I lost 10 positions in my preschools, so which was very detrimental. So they had to cut out the whole third grade of three-year-old classrooms at this point. And so the teachers have had to be notified. Like they said, these are preliminary, but you still have to notify them by a certain day. And then a lot of my schools, that use Title I money, supposed to be supplement, but they're using it to fund positions and fill in where the operating budget's been cut, so they're using the Title I money to get it done. So when that gets cut, that even causes more of a hardship. So those are federal dollars, and we can't really control that. We could just ask them to send us more money, but that's not gonna work. Yeah, you're right. So that's the part that I know, strictly because it affected my schools. I'm sure she'll be able to give us more insight on what she's gonna do or what her recommendation or what's happening there. I do have a question. I guess my ISS instructors in the classrooms, are they being replaced? I mean,
that being Miss Bassett?
Yes.
Miss Bassett, okay.
I'm sorry.
So We have, what we've done is taken a look at our continuum from the DEO recommendations, and we're looking at creating restorative practices in those class, in that, with bringing in more mental health support. So we've upgraded those positions to a higher salary scale so we can attract people with a mental health background, behavior support background.
Okay, I think it's a great idea, but those IS instructors, some are very invaluable inside the school, and you're going to replace those that...
And as I have shared with every principal, we have multiple TA vacancies, and we have them on a priority list. And I can't guarantee everybody can be in their same school because we may not have a vacancy, but we are looking at making sure that they can apply within their same community because we always have TA vacancies across the board.
I understand that. I'm just saying ISS instructors serve a different role than the mental person, I mean, mental health what did you call them, counselors? Or?
Right. What we're looking at is creating what's called a restorative learning center where students have, and we have some real details around that, which I'm happy to provide to the board, okay, to look at utilizing that as our continuum as we look at looking at less punitive measures but more restorative measures to keep students in schools and to make that, create skill sets for students where they learn specific things, specific strategies, and do this restorative work around restoring those relationships, et cetera.
Now, the reason I asked that question also is that there are some ISS instructors that are doing such a good job, the principals do not want to lose them, and they weren't asked if they wanted the restorative person versus the ISS person. So if they had made that decision, the ISS person was doing restorative learning, kind of. It's not all punitive. ISS is not necessarily punitive, it just depends on who is in there and how they are working with the relationships of the kids coming in and out of that room. So that's why I asked that question about ISS instructors being replaced with someone that the kids who knows these ISS instructors and have a relationship with them will now have to do start over with a different type of relationship, and it's just one thing after the other. I'm sorry. But anyway, I understand what you're doing because we do need mental that can do a little better of with social behaviors.
It's not just the mental health. I mean, when you look at best practices, and we've taken a look at other places that have seen a reduction in those ISS and out of school suspension, the way we're currently doing business, we are not seeing reductions that we need to see. So we are trying to look at models where we've seen some real successes and bring some of that to our district so that we can see those decreases and those disparities with ISS and OSS.
Okay. And then we was talking about the site-based budget, and I heard that it's good if you give the schools enough money to do site-based budgeting, but if you don't give them enough money to do it, it sounds good, but it may not work. I did check with a person that's in Nashville that did it, and they said they're having to revamp it because it did not work the way they thought it was going to work. But it sounds good, but we also need to understand you put that on the principals to explain why they did what they did, but they have to do certain things because they're responsible for site-based budgeting, but they don't have enough money in the budget. So we're still back to ground zero on how you're going to explain what happens in the building when you don't have the amount of funding needed to carry on the business that needs to be taken care of.
Thank you, Ms. Dethridge. Ms. Horn.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I have a couple of things. One, I question, maybe Mr. Dupler can answer this or Ms. Owen, but are principals included in the collaborative conferencing? Is administration included in those negotiations? They are, correct?
Yes. Ms. Who wants to speak to that?
I'm going to look at Tanya so she can correct me if I'm wrong. They are part of the management team in collaborative conferencing.
So it's not like the MOU is not binding with principals and assistant principals.
It is binding with the board.
No, but I mean, as far as the salary increase, the 4%, would that have been an MOU strictly between the board and teachers, or would it include principals?
It would be certified staff because the principal salary is based off of the base pay of the teacher.
Okay, that was my question. Thank you. Okay. And then, I have to go back to, I know I've already expressed my frustration with this budget. this budget is more confusing than it needs to be. And I agree with Ms. Fugate that this is, aside from the role of choosing a superintendent, this is the most important thing we do. I don't have a problem with the major categories that we are approving, but I do have a problem with the fact that there are so many unanswered questions, and I don't appreciate approving a budget that I have so many questions about, and that it's, as Ms. Hill said, we don't have all the information that we need. So I'm very frustrated by, I'm sitting here, you know, and I think there's more questions than answers for so many of these things. And I do think it would take several hours to go through. And I'm sure that we all have many of the same questions. You know, I know that the finance department has worked really hard, and I know that you've worked really hard. But there, when I pull out the 2017 budget and look at that, and then I look at the 2017 budget on here, there's differences there that I have questions about. So, like I said, I don't have a problem with the major categories. However, I think we need to talk about what are we going to do this year so that we feel more comfortable with this budget. And then for the following year, we need to have another meeting where we talk about what we want to see as a board so that the finance department has time to react to that and put something into place so that when we approve our budget, we are doing that in full confidence that we understand what's in it. Right now, I feel like we're being asked to vote on a budget that is extremely vague in a lot of areas, and that is not what our community members are expecting us to do. Thank you.
Okay, Mr. McMillan, you waited a long time.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just have three or four things I wish to comment on here. First of all, let me say that, you know, as a board, we're all concerned about the individual cuts. They've hit all of us. Everybody's experienced cuts. Some districts have experienced more than others, but nevertheless, you know, anytime that you lose a position or see somebody lose their job, particularly if they've been in the system for a good number of years, and, you're saddened somewhat by that, whether you're directly involved or not. Now, in reference to your comment, Ms. Fugate, about maybe we needed to have a all-day workshop, I think we probably, most of us could benefit from something of that nature. Personally, I would think that we might, in the future, we might look at maybe a couple or even possibly three small workshops, like 2 hours or something, rather than an all-day deal. But anyway.
We can negotiate that.
Yeah. In reference to a couple of times tonight, the 4% for certified personnel has been mentioned. And we're all familiar with the MOU and everything. The 4% was when the board dealt with that. As best I recall, it was a goal, not a guarantee. There is a difference between a goal and a guarantee. A goal is something you strive for, and even if you do not attain that goal, you don't automatically say that you were not a success. But we all wish that it could have been 4%. But I think Ms. Deathridge and maybe somebody else referred to the pie budget, which is a common mention, or seems to be. And unfortunately, this board does not have the opportunity to make the pie larger, nor do we have the opportunity to go buy another or an additional pie. So we have to deal with what we have. I mean, it's as simple as that. Now, I point back to what the superintendent, Mr. Thomas, said when we started, or before we started the discussion, his comment that as long as we approve the $471 million and stay within the confines of those figures, that we can make adjustments as we go along, as long as you have five board members or more that are willing to do so. So, you know, this budget, we've focused on the negative aspects of it, and rightfully so. But there are a lot of people that this budget helps, too, and a lot of people benefit from it. Therefore, I'm, you know, it's far from perfect, but under the circumstances, I intend to support this. And Ms. Bounds, I know you want to speak, but once you are through with your comments, I'd like to call for the question. Thank you.
Okay, I think, my mic's down. I get
I think the only person is Ms. Fugit.
I'm sorry.
And then we
I'm
can
sorry.
Have.
Thank
okay.
you, Mike.
I thought.
Thank you, Mike.
I didn't
no,
know.
No, mine's just
that.
Down
I thought,
to react.
I thought she
we were
was
getting along here, so I appreciate you letting me do this.
Somebody else that wanted to speak.
The other Ms. blonde.
Ms.
The other.
Ms. Fugit will be the last one to address this Thank budget, you. And then we'll take the vote.
And actually, Mr. McMillan, you addressed a large part of what I wanted to say, which is we just approved the big number today, so that County Commission can approve the big number. I do think that it would behoove us, once we know what the Title I budget is, to if we want to make amendments, we can make amendments. But at some, we're going to have to quit that at some point because people have got to plan. So, you know, I'd say if we're going to make some amendments, we need to do it May and June and be done because people got to plan next school year. The last thing I would say to folks is I've been on this board. This is my seventh budget, and I haven't liked everything in any budget I've approved. That's just statement of fact, because we all have our pet projects. We all have our things near and dear to our hearts and our districts that we try to support. But as Mr. McMillan said, we can't go buy a new pie and we can't make the pie bigger. So that's why I think we always wind up, unfortunately, many of us have to vote. We all probably wind up voting for a budget that we don't agree with every item in it. So that concludes my remarks.
Okay, we had a motion and a second, and it's been a long time, so I don't remember who made those. Ms. Fugit and Terry Hill. So we are voting now on the general purpose budget. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed.
No.
Okay, so the motion carries. Ms. Coatney, and you're ready.
Item 8, approve the fiscal year 2018 capital improvement plan for $10 million.
Motion approved.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Norman, seconded by Mr. McMillan. We'll open up the floor to discussion. Oh. Yes. Okay. No.
It's never enough money.
Okay. So, all in favor of this capital improvement of the motion as it is presented, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed. Motion carries. So, before we do board forum, I would just like to say a couple of things, just kind of to wrap up the evening. First, I want to thank all the board members for what I see and interpret as your deep concerns for students. And I see that in the detailed discussion and questions and suggestions that occurred tonight. And I think there's a lot we agree upon. And so I think that's great moving forward. And secondly, if it's the will of this board, I will direct Ms. Coatney to find a date or dates for Mr. McMillan for a budget. Just a general discussion of learning more about the budgeting process and workshop later, maybe in the summer or sometime. The nice thing is that All of us will remain on this board next year, and there are no new elections, so I think this is a good time to implement Ms. Fugit's suggestion. And finally, I'd like to thank Gary Spencer and his team for what has been, even with the discussion we've had tonight, the most transparent and detailed budget since I've been on this board. And I know we want more, and we want it to look, and that can be a conversation we have with our newly elected superintendent. But thank you for your hard work, and thank you because, trust me, from those of us who came on the board 3 years ago, this is the most transparent and detailed budget that we have ever seen. So thank you to Mr. Spencer, and we will go to board forum now. And why don't we start over here with Sydney tonight? Okay, Gloria, Jennifer, Tony.
Good. Let's go.
Okay, Ms. Roundtree?
No.
Horn? Hill? McMillan? Okay.
Move adjourn.
Y'all can't say it fast enough. Meeting adjourned.